we started with Micah. Micah chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. That's going to be our text for the next 2 weeks, to this week and next week and last week. Of course, we started with the first one, which was what? What was last week? Three parts to Micah. One is it's do, right? And today would be love, right? And next week will be to walk. And so this is what we're doing. And so this week we want to just recap a little bit of last week because it's that important. But we also want to read the text again. So if you could turn with me to Micah chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. Here's what it says. And it's the prophet, obviously the Lord speaking to his people. Listen to what the Lord says, verse 6. Chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. Listen to what the Lord says. Stand up, plead my case before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say. Hear you, mountains, the Lord's accusation. Wow. Listen, you everlasting foundations of the earth. For the Lord is a case against his people. He's lodging a charge against Israel. Verse 3, my people, what have I done to you? How have I burdened you? Answer me. I brought you up out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. I sent Moses to lead you, also Aaron and Miriam. My people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, plotted and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered. Remember your journey from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? What am I to bring to him? Is what this is saying, right? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings and calves a year old? Verse 7. Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Now, I gotta tell you, I love me some good olive oil. Okay, let me move on. Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He's making deals. In sarcasm, he's saying, you're trying to make deals with me. We talked about that. And once again, here's the focus for this week. Verse 8. He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So as we spoke last week, God has a case against his people. Just a quick summary here. He reminds them and us of all that he's done and all that he points out. Listen, I don't know about you, but during worship, I feel like God was doing that again. I feel like God was pointing out, here's my mercy, here's my grace, here's my forgiveness. Don't stand on the outside looking in. Don't stand on the outskirts. Don't, listen, you come to church, we hear these people on TV, we maybe have a religious family member. Don't stand on the outside. Step in. Step into the presence of the Lord. That mercy, that grace, it's for you. It's for me. But I have to accept it. And if I accept it, and I accept it truly, I'm not a Calvinist, I'm an Arminianist. What does that mean? Well, a Calvinist would say that you've got to kind of earn grace. You got to work for salvation. But an Arminianist says that we are saved by grace. That's my belief. However, I also believe this, and I have to be very careful about this. I believe that if I am saved by grace, it will cause works. You hear me? Let me say that again real quick. It's not a Bible study. It's a sermon, and so I don't want to get too far into it. I don't believe that I have to jump through hoops and spin my wheels and go through specific ceremonies in order to be saved. I have to be saved by grace, by the accepting and the acknowledgement that Jesus is the Son of God and he died for me. And I'm a sinner and I need him and I need rescuing. And he does that. And I'm saved. However, having said that, once I accept that grace, once I accept that mercy, everything about my life ought to begin to look different. It may not be overnight. It may not be right away. It may not be instantaneous. But at some point, my life's going to look different because I've accepted grace and mercy and forgiveness. And now there's a new boss on the throne. And so my life won't look the way it did when I was in charge. Say amen to that. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty glad my life doesn't look like what it used to when I was in charge. So he reminds them of all that he's done for them, and he's doing that this morning, and he did it in a special way during worship, which is why I'm taking a few extra moments to point it out. It was in here to begin with. I had it in my notes to begin with to talk about the fact that God is reminding them and us of all that he's done for us. But then when the word came during the worship, when the Spirit was moving, that he sort of indicated that again, mercy, grace, and does it change you? Does it make us walk different? Or is it just a really, really pleasant placebo? A what? A placebo, a sugar pill. I come to church, I feel good. I listen to Christian music for a little bit. I get in the car, live any way I want to. Or you might be a very religious person, and you come in and you listen to the Christian music and you walk out to your car, and you're still playing your Christian station, but you know those things in your life, they're not honoring God. You just don't want to give it up. You like what you do. We're so good at justifying stuff. It's so easy for us to look at our life and say, God, I know I shouldn't be watching that stuff on TV. I know I shouldn't really be watching that stuff. I know I really shouldn't be doing that on the internet. I know I shouldn't really be listening to this thing. And I know I probably shouldn't be hanging out with these people. I know I probably shouldn't allow anger to make me say the things I say. I know, I get all that. Listen, mercy has to change me, or it's spent for nothing. Grace has to make me live and walk and talk and think differently, or it's for naught. So he reminds them and points out that gestures and ceremonies, this is God, don't impress him. You're going to bring me thousands of rivers of oil? You're going to kill thousands of rams? So what? I don't care. You're going to serve in this ministry. You're going to serve in that ministry. You're going to get up real early twice a year and go to this community thing. Or you're going to do this grand gesture for the church. None of that impresses him at all. He doesn't care about that. You know what he cares about? Just simply get up every day and be faithful and consistent and follow me and obey what I told you to do. That's Micah 6, 1 through 8. That's it. That's the whole thing. God has told you, O mortal, what is good and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love mercy or kindness and to walk humbly with your God. So there's really no magic way, as we discussed last week, there's no magic way to make things right with you and God. You're not going to impress him, but only what we have always known to do. Now, it's a simple premise. Let's not oversimplify it. It is a simple premise, but let's not oversimplify it. Knowing is one thing, doing is another altogether. Julian, go clean your room. Okay. 20 minutes later, I'm in his room. Place looks like a bomb went off. Julian, did you clean your room? Put your clothes away. Put the toys in the bin. Put the live animal back outside. Whatever, right? I know, Dad. It doesn't matter that you know. You didn't do it. How many times does God look at me and say, I don't care that you know. You're not doing it. So look what Paul says in Romans 7:19, because this is a struggle that we'll always face, to do the right thing at the right time, because we're human. Look at what Paul says in Romans 7:19. He says, for I do not do the good that I want to, but it's the evil I do not want to do. That's what I keep doing. Can you just hear humanity in his verse? Can you just hear his plight? Can you hear what he's saying like a normal person? Oh my goodness. And he's talking to the Romans. For the stuff that I want to do that I know that is right, that I know that is good, I don't do it. But the very evil stuff that I don't want to do, that's what I end up doing. This is Paul talking. What chance do I have if Paul's not making it? But here's the thing. He's making it by grace. And he just presses on and presses on, right? And that's the same boat that we're in, that I'm in, right? I think this does a pretty good job. I think that verse does a fantastic job, in fact, of describing our human condition as Christian. Listen, let's be super honest this morning. Ever play Truth or Dare? Listen, I've played truth or dare games that you know as well as I do. I should never have played. Ever. But let's just be real honest this morning. Let's be honest. Let's just be honest. Our spirit maybe wants to do the right thing. Maybe. Right? Especially after Sunday church. You know, God moved a certain way, and the preacher was okay today, I guess. And the worship was so good. They played my favorite song, all as well. So we leave church all psyched, all enthused, and all, oh, you know what? Yeah, I'm going to do this. God is going to do something special. And by the time we get home, that was pretty good, I thought. I didn't practice that, I want you to know, but it was pretty good. Listen. Our earthly flesh, for one hot minute, we're all on fire. And if we're not careful, gravity just pulls me back down. Gravity and reality just pulls me back down into my earthly flesh. And because we're being super honest with ourselves, here's what that means that my flesh pulls me into. Shame, anger, laziness. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Laziness, lust, self-indulgence, pride, self-interest, offense, yeah, holding a grudge against someone, yeah, that's in there, because it separates you from God, it separates me from God. I'm not allowed to stay angry. Grudges, envy, fear, arrogance, gravity pulled my flesh right back down, greed. All those good intentions just fizzle away. I won't make the sound again, but it was a good one. I hope it got recorded well, because I'm listening to this later. And self gets in the way. Self gets in the way. So we really are in a spiritual battle against good and evil. That's the truth inside of our own selves. We are quick to point fingers. My dad didn't raise me. My parent, you have no idea what I've been. Yeah, I don't care. Wow, Mr. Sensitivity. Yeah, no, I don't care. I told you once before, I am not a nice person in and of myself. I did. I was honest with you. It is God. It is God. It's the grace of Christ in me that makes me go, dummy, don't say that. Don't say that. Be loving. Be kind. We'll get to that in a minute. But in and of myself, I am not nice. And so I hear you. I hear you when you say, you don't know what I've been through or where I came from. It's an excuse. Get over it. Wow, that's not going to win any awards anywhere. Listen, the reason I can say that to you is because it's been said to me over and over and over. I've been through hell and back. It's still my fault, what I choose to do, right? I won't get into detail, but you know, some of you know. I see some young faces in here. We don't need to go into detail. But you heard parts of the story. It's all, if I'm honest with myself, it was always my fault. Oh, I blamed my father for a while, then I blamed my mother for a while, and then I blamed, whatever, the mailman for a while. Anybody that was it. In the proximity, was about to be blamed. Oh, it was my school district, and it was a pretty bad school district, not going to lie. But anyway, the point is, it is my struggle. It is my struggle, nobody else's. We really are in a spiritual battle against our own selves, as well as the enemy, the devil. Yes, right, the Bible says that. I know that's true. Satan roams around like a monster looking to devour and destroy people. However, I got to tell you this. The devil gets a lot of credit for stuff he didn't do. Just saying. The devil gets a lot of credit for stuff I did my own self. But then I'm out of people to blame. I can't even blame him, right? You should say amen to that, probably. I hope it's true. But the good news is, here's the thing. Here's the other side of that. The other side of that is that the Lord is continually, first of all, he's on your side. Jesus is, we just came out of Easter. Jesus is on your side. He's there for you. He's on your side. There's no agenda. There's no manipulation other than I want to rescue this poor chump. That's God. That's Jesus for me, right? And the good news is that he's constantly trying to help me, encouraging all of that. The Spirit of God is constantly going to speak to me in a million different ways. However, he's got to talk to me. Listen, he'll talk to me through a box of gummy bears if I'm not listening. Whatever he needs to do to get to me, to talk to me, it might be a relative, it might be a friend, it might be a sermon, it might be a pastor. He will talk to me. The Spirit will constantly help me. That's what he does, right? Hebrews 13, 20 and 21 says this. Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, happy Easter, the great shepherd of the sheep, verse 21, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Once I accepted Christ, once I understand, wow, that mercy, it's for me. I didn't deserve it, but I've got it now. Now I have to understand now Christ is living within me and he's equipping. Whatever I do wrong, whenever I don't walk a straight line, it's my fault and nobody else's, because he's already equipped me with everything I needed to do it. What do you mean? Well, you know, that's pretty harsh. What happened to all that struggle talk? Listen, that's what Micah's about. Do the right thing. Do justly and love mercy and walk humbly. Because why? Because he said it. You already know. Read Micah 6, 1 and 8 again. You'll see that. So here's the thing, for the most part, I do believe that for most of us, we do have a pretty good understanding of what it means to please God. Listen, some 3,000 years ago, God is calling his people back. He's saying, you know what to do. Come, do the right thing. He's calling them back. Several thousand years ago, he's still doing the same thing. You're saved. You're saved by the blood of my son, Jesus. Just do the right thing, right? We're called to justice. We're called to do that. We're also called to love mercy, to love kindness, for lack of a better word, which is what today's message is, right? Now, here's the thing. The word for kindness, the word for mercy is chesed. Don't spit at anyone, but turn to your neighbor and go, chesed. That was fun to watch. I might do that again later, but anyway. So this word, this term chesed, is so much, it's more than mercy. We use the word mercy, but the truth is, the American language, trust me, I speak a number of them, and languages, and so you'd know, believe me, in other languages, that one word in English, there's about 13 words in other languages for that same word. So when I say to you, the word chesed can mean 12 different things. The word mercy, it's not just mercy. It means it's a whole theme. That's a principle of kindness, compassion, warmth. It's a sense of selfless love. There's a lot in that word. Love, mercy doesn't just mean be warm and fuzzy. Love, mercy means embrace this kindness, this compassion, this kind of a mentality, this lifestyle of selfless devotion to something or someone other than yourself. Wow, does that not fit our culture? Or mine. It's so much more than smiling at people walking down the sidewalk. How many know that if you go to the South, and if you're from North Jersey, from Philadelphia, from Berks County first, right? And then you like go to school. I went to Missouri to school, Springfield, at CBC, and I'm walking down the street. People are like, good morning. I'm like, what do you want? That was me for months. For months, I'm like, I'm at Dunkin' Donuts getting a coffee. All these people are like just smiling at me. Like, what do you want from me? I don't know you. It took me a long time to go, oh, they're just being friendly. I didn't get that. That wasn't in my makeup. Wasn't in my nature. The way we were raised, not anybody else's fault but mine. Just being clear. Listen, but the truth is, it's more than that. It's more than fondness. It's more than friendliness. It's deeper than that. It's being kind and compassionate to the person that ticked you off. It's being sweet and loving to the person that you have a fight with or a grudge with. They owe you something. How dare they? That's where God says, love mercy. I'm not allowed to hold offense. I'm not allowed to hold grudges. It separates me from Christ. But Pastor, you don't understand how bad they hurt me. Yes, I do. I've been hurt that way too. I don't have the right. If I say to my God, I accept your grace, I accept your mercy that I didn't deserve, that I did not merit. If I say to my God, I accept your forgiveness, your kindness to me, I accept your chesed, then that means that there's nobody that could have wronged me more than I wronged God. And that means I have to let it go. Offense destroys people. It ruins hearts. Fantastic book called The Bait of Satan. If you have in your life, hear me, if you have in your life a place where you're thinking, oh boy, because I know when I start talking about this, the Holy Spirit starts touching people's lives right on their heart and goes, remember what's his name? Remember what's her name? That's what happens when I talk about this stuff. It's hard to avoid, to be honest. And if you have something like that, you come talk to me. I have a book I want you to read by John Bevere called The Bait of Satan. The Bait of Satan. Think of it on a hook, like a worm. It's a fence. It's to be. I've been wronged. There's an injustice been perpetrated against me. So what? Nobody perpetrated a greater injustice than what I did to the Lord. And yet, what does he give me? Grace, mercy, forget, love, mercy. Do justly, love, mercy. Wow, not easy to do. Really easy to say. But it's the kind of love, this chesed, the kind of love that spouses pledge to each other, that parents have instinctively for children. It means steadfast, means never ending, all of that. It's the kind of love that God has for us, and he has an abundance of it. So God isn't really just calling us to be pleasant people. He's not just calling us to be nice. See, because I've been in environments and atmospheres where there's Christians and they're all friendly and they love each other, but they'll begin to talk to each other like this. When somebody talks to you like this, red flags should go up. Oh, but you know, they really hurt you. I don't think you owe them anything. Be careful. Red flags should go up. God didn't owe us anything either. And yet, he forgave me. You want me to put myself back in an abusive situation? No. Don't read into what I'm saying. This is a heart thing. This doesn't happen on paper. This doesn't happen at town halls. This doesn't happen in municipal places. This happens in your heart. You hear me? There's not a pastor alive worth his salt that would tell a woman or a man or a child that's being abused in some way. Physically, sexually, oh, God forgive, God have mercy. It's going on all over the place. No pastor would say you have to stay in that place and suffer. But every pastor worth his salt who reads the word will say you've got to get past it. You've got to let mercy be in your heart because it will destroy you, not them. So he's calling us to love. And here's where it sounds so easy and then in the end it's not. He's calling us to love like God loves. You don't have to subject yourself to torture and hurt and abuse and all of that. You don't, but you do have to go before God and say, Lord, I didn't deserve this. This hits home for me in a big way. You know this, many of you. There's a lot I didn't need forgiveness. I didn't deserve forgiveness for it. And yet here I stand on this platform preaching the word of God, still thinking, how did I get here? I mean, you've been saying that for 3 years. Oh, I'll probably be saying it for a lot longer than that. How did I get here? Because the mercy wasn't deserved. Let me move on. Here's what I'm saying. These tiny little words in the verse that appear right after do justice, these two little words, love, mercy, they mean for me and you, they mean for us to stretch beyond ourselves. To stretch beyond ourselves. Don't just react, be proactive. Love each other. Love people. Be kind. Be merciful. It sounds so easy. It's so not. It means to throw out the term religious altogether. That's what this means. This message of love, mercy means throw the term out religion altogether and follow James 1:27. Here's what it says. James 1:27, religion that God our Father accepts. Stop there for a moment, because what does it mean? Well, it means that there's religion that he doesn't accept. Huh? Listen, if there is a religion that God sees as pure and right, then there's also a religion that God says, I don't know what that is, but you're not worshiping me. That's the truth. So let me go on. Verse 27 of James chapter 1, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself, this is so important, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. What does that mean? True religion, your version might say an undefiled, depends what you're reading, but religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is to look after orphans and widows. Well, that makes sense. Take care of the less fortunate, whatever, right? In their distress. Pure religion also means keep yourself from being polluted by the world. What are we doing? We watch what anyone else watches. We read whatever we want to read. Nobody's checking out what you do. What movies are you going to see? Oh, Pastor, really? Isn't this a youth sermon? No, unfortunately, it's not. Because I'm a grown-up, and I hear people all the time. Pastor, I can't sleep. Pastor, I have no peace. Pastor this, pastor that. I have a problem with this person. I have an issue here. Or they don't say anything to me, but I see them. They're not plugged in. They can't get connected. And when I find out this is what they're doing, I realize, wow, that's a lot of garbage that you're letting in your life. Why would you expect the Spirit of God to move in your life? These aren't my words. These aren't my words. Don't get angry at me, right? Because I know some of you are. Listen. Religion that God our Father accepts is pure is to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Fill in the blanks. Goes back to do the right thing, do justice. Anything can be religious. Look, the definition of religion, all the definition of religion is the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a god or gods, plural. I can worship Underdog if I want to. I can make a religion of Mighty Mouse. It could still be completely fake and false. We sang What a Wonderful Name It Is, that song that we sang at the end of the service. I love that song. It's one of my favorite songs right now. Listen, there's a lot of names in this world. Nothing stirs up as much angst as Jesus. You mention that name, everybody loses their mind. You can say Ganesh, you could say Muhammad. With a little group of people here or with a little group of people there, you might get some reaction. Say Jesus anywhere, everyone goes nuts. In one direction or the other. It's either yes or that's horrible that they would force that. Listen, you can worship something with legs like snakes. I don't even know what that God's name is. There's a whole bunch. It's honest to goodness, it's crazy. I don't even like the research for this because I'm like, seriously? This is what they're worshiping? They're worshiping like a hot dog with eyes and like little toothpicks in it. And they're like, are you kidding me? Listen, religion is just a term for venerating anything. My son can make a religion of fidget spinners. Does anybody know what a fidget spinner is? Good heavens, about a month ago, he's got one right there. Stand up, young man. Just go like this. Now, see that in his hand? It's too small for me. I'm 45. I can't see that thing. Okay, stop it for a second so I can see what kind it is. Is it? Oh, it's one of those. Nice. Listen to me. I know you all are like, he needs prayer. Listen to me. You can make a religion of anything. A month ago, I didn't even know what a fidget spinner was. Now my children are addicted to them. Thank you, Angela. Oh, yeah, I'm calling you out. Listen to me. We can make a religion of anything we've got in our life. The thing is, we don't see it that way. No, Pastor, I go to church. Yeah, you go to about 10 different churches every week. What? You go to 10 different churches. You worship in 10 different places every week. What do you mean? I mean that you're here now worshiping. When you're watching something, when you're doing something, when you're spending time, when you're pouring your energy and your resources and all of that somewhere else, guess what? That becomes your church. Some of it's okay and some of it is not. And the only person that can answer that is you. The only person that can answer that is you, because you will not find me parked outside your window on a Monday morning. Some of you may, but we've made that deal. So, we've already talked about that. So, anyway, but if I choose to worship as our Father accepts, if I choose to worship as God truly intends me to, then that means it's pure and faultless. And then I have to learn to cultivate this sense of chesed, this sense of mercy, of love, of kindness, a very selfless thing. We're to radiate the very same compassion that God gave me. That's not easy to do. The more of it I soak in, the more ammunition I have to spend. But if I go throughout my day, I didn't read my Bible, I didn't spend any time in prayer, I didn't soak anything in. Is this legit? You saying we're sponges? Is that somewhere in Leviticus? Look, garbage in, garbage out. This is a strong principle. It's a normal principle. If I'm in the Word and in prayer and I'm in contact with the Holy Spirit, He's going to guide me. He's going to direct the footsteps of a righteous man are ordered of God. But if I'm not talking to Him, I have no idea what He'd want me to do. Then somebody comes up to me, they say, you know, buddy, you go to church, don't you, pal? What do you think I should do? And from my empty reservoir, where I haven't prayed and I haven't read the Word, I go, well, let's see. My experience indicates that the right thing to say right now would be this, this, and this. And more terrible advice had been given by Christians because they're not prepared at all than have been given by non-Christians who think it through a little differently. How sad is that? Okay, nobody's talking to me. I hear crickets in the background, except Elaine. Thank you. Anyway, let me move on. God says, I've loved you faithfully. And that's what we do. Let's get the worship team up here, can we? Just play something, anything. Yeah, that's you. He's looking around. Now, I want to be kind right now, but yeah, you're it. You're him. You're the... Amen. Listen, here's the absolute truth. This is the absolute truth. We cannot extend godliness unless we're walking in godliness. Don't fake it. There's a lot of religious people. There's a lot of spiritual-looking people. Don't fake it. You cannot extend righteousness unless you're living in righteousness. Not perfect. Not perfection. But you're simply walking in grace. We've had this conversation before. Right? And in the same way, today's subject matter, love, mercy. You can't extend mercy like we ought to unless you accept it, unless we grasp the mercy that we've received. Unless I'm walking in the mercy and the grace that changes me, it's very hard for me to offer it to the people in my world because I don't fully understand it. You hit me, I'm going to hit you back. That's not mercy. That's not mercy. That's not chesed. I still love saying that. Listen, that's you do to me and I'm going to do back to you. You do what I don't like and I'm going to get on Facebook. Come on, Christians and non-Christians alike. Be honest. Tell the truth and shame the devil. I hate what I see sometimes. Foolish, hurtful, damaging things that don't have any place in the life of a Christian coming out of our mouth or coming off of our fingers. It is an exercise in loving others. It is an exercise in loving other people for me to sit back and remind myself of all God had to overlook. It is an exercise in loving people for me to sit back and say, oh God, all that you had to overlook in my life. And how many people and things and I could go back and think of all the damage that I've caused. and all the heartache and all of that. And yet, God chose to take me out of this place of desperation and fill me with mercy and grace. But doesn't stop there. Then he says, hey, listen, some of you in this room are really young. Some of you in this room, all you're getting saved from is M&Ms. But don't eat too many of them, because those will destroy you too. So that can be legit. Don't play it down. Listen, you might be young in here. Listen, hear me. God loves you so much that if he could, he would spare you from many things. Young or old alike in this room, I don't know what you've been through. If God can spare you from something, he will. But he will also let you go through certain things to make you better, to make you stronger. Don't look back. Don't look back in self-pity. Oh man, could we do that? Couldn't we? We could sit back and look at our life in self-pity. Oh, you don't know what I've done and what I'm... I could do that. So could you. Many of you. That's not what he asks of me. He asks me to sit back and instead of going, woe is me, how would I ever get past this? How can I ever get better? He sits me down and says, all of that mercy, all of that grace, it's all to restore me and to renew me and to repair me and make me something I never was. And then he says, now you go out and do that for someone else. Introduce them to me. And then the Holy Spirit does the same thing for them. That's awesome. It is simple, but that's awesome. Amen. I love what it did. I love what mercy did for me. I love what God did for me. I'll never stop sharing what Christ did for my life. And I'm going to share that mercy with anyone I can get my hands on. And I don't mean like hands on, like around their neck with mercy. I get angry still. I'd like to bless somebody with a brick once in a while. Listen to me. I have to keep reminding myself. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I'm not going back there. I can't share any of the illustrations I wanted to share because of something that God put in my heart. So I'm not going to. Okay, listen, can I just say this and we'll close? If we don't develop that sense of how merciful God has been to us, if we don't intentionally, actively develop that sense in ourselves of, yes, God, I accept your grace, I accept your mercy. I'm not going to dwell there, but I'm going to let you restore me and renew me so that I can bless someone else. That's where we need to be. And if we can't do that, it's going to be very difficult to be merciful. It's going to be very difficult to do the second part of our series, to love mercy and act in it. I have seen so many times in my own life, even as a pastor, when I wanted to act in justice, I wanted to act in righteousness. I have a right. I'm the pastor. I can come in and I can say and do this. It's right. It's right. But then something would speak to my heart and God would say, no, act in mercy. And so I would. And every single time I gave that thing to the Lord, it works out better than how I would have worked it out. Thank you, Lord is right. Thank God your pastor knows how to shut up and get out of the way. I think it's my best feature. That's horrible. Anyway, I gotta move on. Anyway, listen, I have avoided countless problems. I have, and I've made some, but I've avoided countless problems simply by saying, Lord, just keep my mouth shut. Let me act in kindness and mercy. It's not what I want to do right now, but it's what I'm going to do. And God comes in and he does it better than I would have done it. Letting go of what I'm owed. You hear me? Let go of what you're owed. There might be people that owe you something. spiritually, emotionally, physically, financially. There might be somebody that owes you. Let it go. Let it go. Another illustration for another time. In my own family, relatives, my father, who's in heaven now, my uncles, things that have happened, let it go. Let God be your justice. Number one, do the right thing. Number two, love mercy. And next week, number three, walk humbly. Will you stand with me? We're going to pray. Lord, I ask not because we jump through the right hoops or because we follow some sort of program or some sort of ceremony or tradition. God, not because of any of that. I ask that you would pour your mercy out and your grace because you are so kind. Will you make us like that? Lord, you told us to be like you, to be like Jesus. Will you help us to be kind? We fail so often in so many ways. But Lord, I ask right now for myself and for every person in this room that your Holy Spirit would wake us up internally. Wake us up. Set an alarm clock off. Something. Remind us. God, make us kind, merciful, compassionate to the people around us. Whatever that means, whatever that looks like. God, I pray if there's somebody here who's struggling with a relationship or with a memory or with hurt or with something in their past that it's so hurtful and it's so buried deeply, I pray that we would give you, Father, the permission. No, not just the permission, God, but the request to dig it out. And it might hurt, but dig it out. God, I pray that in this room, there would be nobody here who doesn't acknowledge and hear this right now, that we are not able to move forward in mercy and in grace and in growth until we can let go of anger and grudges and hate. God, you are so good at this. We thank you for that. We thank you in advance for all that you're going to do. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, I just said amen and three people said it too. I'm going to say it again. Help us, Lord, to be kind. Can you say amen? That's better. Thank you. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Listen, there's one more thing we have to do before we go. We won't keep you. I promise we won't keep you long. But there is an announcement that we need to make. Now, before I do that, I want to be very clear that if you're in this room and you